Managing scalable VPNs doesn't have to be complicated. Tailscale makes it fairly effortless. By building on WireGuard, one of the fastest and most efficient VPN protocols available, Tailscale adds a management layer that simplifies the setup, reduces latency, and even tackles some NAT traversal challenges. Today we'll break down the basics of how it works, showcase it on a few different platforms, and get a few devices onboarded into our Tailnet. Let's get started. At its core, a VPN is just a way to connect otherwise independent networks. Whenever we configure these VPNs, there's always a few challenges we have to address, and traditionally these revolve around performance, scalability, and NAT. Performance-wise, Tailscale uses something called WireGuard as its data plane. WireGuard is a super efficient open source system to create encrypted tunnels. It uses CHA-CHA-20 as its encryption algorithm and private and public keys for authentication. In practice, making point-to-point connections with WireGuard is actually really simple. Even a VPN with a couple endpoints isn't too complicated, but it does require a bit of technical know-how depending on how you run it. This can make scaling a little bit more difficult, but Tailscale implements a control plane over the top of WireGuard that fixes that, and it also helps out with any NAT issues. This control plane is what makes Tailscale so great to use. It allows you to utilize all these technologies very easy. It allows you to manage your users and devices from a single screen, and you can easily invite others to your personal network called a tailnet and revoke their access when needed. Traditional VPN architecture can be a little bit complicated. We mostly use what's called a hub and spoke network. For example, let's talk about a small business with a few remote employees. In most cases, what we would do is designate one office location as the main VPN host. All remote users call home to this location to get a connection. This isn't super efficient and it builds a single point of failure. I mean, think about it. If a remote user wants to talk to another remote user, it has to traverse the main office to make that connection. The better way to do this would be to build a mesh node where every device calls home directly to another client whenever it needs to talk to that client. So no additional hops to add latency or add points of failure. Could you imagine trying to build out that architecture by hand, keeping track of tons of public and private keys? I mean, what happens if a device is behind a double NAT like a Starlink? This could get super complicated. Tailscale's coordination system is actually quite ingenious. Once you have a device onboarded, it talks directly to the coordination server and it knows about all of your different endpoints. It builds these direct point-to-point connections as needed. And if one of your devices is behind a double NAT, you don't have to do any port forwarding. The Tailscale coordination system sends it to a DERP server or a designated encryption relay for packets. This is just a server that acts as a relay between your client. It uses technologies like STUN and ICE to make this happen. And if you're worried about the security of a DERP server, let me put your mind at ease. That DERP server doesn't actually have the ability to unencrypt your traffic. It's simply just forwarding it along to where it needs to go. If you were really concerned about it, you could spin up your own DERP server, but that's totally unnecessary. With this coordination service in place, you can easily make changes to users and access on the fly without touching their devices. So let's go ahead and set up a tailnet and get a few devices connected in. We're going to get a few devices onboarded here in just a second, but I wanted to show you the meat and potatoes of this dashboard. This is where everything happens inside of Tailscale. The first things to note are machines and users. This is the basics of Tailscale and how it works. Every device that gets onboarded into your organization is a machine, and you get 100 of those for free. Every person that logs in on these machines is considered a user. For home networking, think of it this way. Maybe the family members each have a login. You're going to give this to yourself and two others, but you're going to have this on many machines. Maybe your cell phone, your iPad, your laptop, and then maybe your spouse's cell phone, iPad, and laptop. I'm going to say for a free account, that's actually a pretty good deal. They're giving you all of this. I haven't yet outran it. If you do need to upgrade, it's not super expensive. So first of all, let's go ahead and add a machine into this. I'll first just add my Windows laptop. It's super simple. All I need to do is click add a device, client device, and here it allows you to either enter an email or copy the link. Basically, this is just the installer. So once you download this and install it, you'll actually have this down in your system tray. If you click down here, you can see that I have the little Tailscale icon. The first thing it's going to have me do is it's going to redirect me to an online page to have me sign in. Now, I'm going to sign in with my GitHub account because that's where my organization is. I'll allow it to authorize it. And it's going to give me one more warning saying, hey, you're about to join this tailnet. Are you sure you want to do that? I sure do. So we'll get connected. And it'll basically send an authentication token here to the local Tailscale program. And we can see a little bit more about it here. we see that we are connected to the Telnet. We see my username and information, and of course, this device's name and its IP address on the Telnet. And actually, here we go. It opened me back up to the dashboard, and under my machines, you can already see this right here. You can see my desktop. So every device that's connected to your Telnet, of course, has an IP address. So this is what it is on that local net. The other cool thing about this is something called Magic DNS. If you've managed VPNs before, if you have local servers you're trying to access with a domain name, that can be complicated to keep track of. Natively, things like WireGuard don't have a system in place to keep DNS entries up to date. So normally you have to forward this to like a Windows server at the main location and then keep all these entries up to date. And how this always works, it's always the machine name dot the Telnet address. You can always see your Telnet address up in the upper left-hand corner of Tailscale. That was super simple. We have my Windows machine up and online. Let's go ahead and get another device quickly enrolled. Let's take, for example, my iPhone here. Once I download the Tailscale app and launch it, it's very easy to get onboarded. All I have to do is go here and click login and add my account, the same one that I've been using before, and it will get me right into my Telnet. And while we're taking a look here, you can see every device that's connected to your Telnet from the screen. I really like that feature because if we had like a NAS drive connected to this and I forgot the IP address of it, I can see it right from that screen. I can also see its Magic DNS information. Now, these are both very simple examples of Telnet machines. There's other types here that we should talk about. The first one is adding something like a subnet router. The example of this would maybe be you have an office that has a good pfSense router there and you don't want to install Tailscale on every single machine behind it. You'd rather just put the router in place and let that happen. Let me show you how simple that is to get set up. In my example here, I have just a NetGate 4200 connected to the internet, which is behind DoubleNAT because it's going through my home network, and has a Casa OS device behind it, just as a client for us to test with. Once I log into my pfSense device here, I can simply go to VPN Tailscale. If this isn't already installed for you, it should be. You can go to the System Package Manager and get this installed yourself. Once we get to this location, we gotta go to the Authentication tab. How this works is essentially with a pre-authentication key. We can generate this back on the Tailscale dashboard. This is really simple to do. Whenever we're here at the dashboard on Tailscale, we just go to Settings, we click on Keys, and we have to generate an auth key. We'll go ahead and give it a name of NetGate, and we'll click Generate Key. We'll copy that, and we'll go back here over to this page and paste it in. Once we got that key pasted in there, we'll just go to Settings and click Enable. And if we go over here the status, we can see its relationship to the Telnet. And right away, we can see the other Telnet devices under here. At the moment, this NetGate is just a standard type of client, just like our iPhone here. If we want to advertise routes below it, like the local network 192.168.1.0/24, we have to head over in the settings and go ahead and add that as an advertised route. As soon as we add those advertised routes into the Tailscale network, it tells the control plane, hey, I'm trying to advertise this subnet. If we head back over into the dashboard, we'll see this little notification saying subnets. Basically, as the administrator, we have to approve that. That's a really good feature so that if users are kind of playing around with their settings, they can't accidentally do that without knowing what it does. So we'll go ahead and click on it. And then inside of here, we see the information we have to review. So let's go ahead and click review. We'll go ahead and approve that. And now everybody who's on our Telnet can actually see that subnet. Let's go ahead and test it out. So here on my Windows machine, you can see at 192.168.1.102, we have my Casa OS device. What I'm gonna do here is fire up my iPhone, go ahead and make sure I'm connected to the Telnet, and I'm gonna try to get to that over LTE. So you can see here up in the taskbar, I don't have Wi-Fi connected. So let's go ahead and go to 192.168.1.102 and see what pops up. And boom, just like that. So you can see I'm on LTE, and then I did get my Casa OS board pulled up. So this means I am tunneling through our Telnet, through the NetGate, and down into the Casa OS. So up to this point, we have our standard devices connected, like our iPhone and laptop. We've also added a subnet router, which shares the local network below it. The last thing we should talk about is an exit node. We've already spoke a little bit about the exit node. Essentially, this is a way for a device like a router to share its ISP connection for folks to tunnel all of their traffic through. The example is that Rode Warrior VPN. Maybe somebody's out at a coffee shop and they want to use a little bit of extra privacy to make sure all their traffic's encrypted and goes out the ISP connection of the NetGate. Let's go ahead and show you how easy that is to set up. Back over in the PFSense box, we already have everything connected. All we have to do here is actually click Advertise Exit Node. By doing this, we're effectively turning this NetGate router into a subnet router as well as that exit node. So as that's being applied, we head back over to the dashboard and we see this new alert saying, hey, PFSense is trying to be an exit node. We have to approve this. This is under the same thing here, under Review, and click Use as Exit Node. Once we click Save, now our devices can tunnel all of their internet traffic through that NetGate. Back over to the trusty iPhone, let's go ahead and show you how you enable that. If we go back into the TailScale network, you can see the exit node is selected as none. This means we're not sending all of our traffic over TailScale. You normally don't want to do that unless you're trying to secure your entire connection. If we click here, we can see we have the option of none or PFSense. This is one of my favorite features of TailScale. If you have many exit nodes, they'll all show up here, so you get to choose as the user which one to connect to. And just like that, we have a full tailnet setup. We have all of our devices on here. We have a subnet router. We have an exit node. I'd be remiss not to show you the other things inside this dashboard. It's so powerful. The first one is users. You know, I said anybody who wants to log into your tailnet has to have a username and password or that key that we generated, the pre-auth key. Let's say we wanted to invite one of our family members to our tailnet. All we would have to do is click Invite External User and send them an email or send them an invite link. Last but not least is access control. This is basically, think of it as the firewalling. It's basically the way to restrict different users and machines from different parts of the tailnet. This is a very well thought out mechanism, but it is fairly advanced. I'm going to give you the rundown, but if this is a little bit too much for you, you should definitely reach out to us at Rogue Support, as our rogues are TailScale experts. The reason why I say this is a little bit complicated is because it's in JSON format. It's not like traditional firewalls inside of like UniFi or NetGate. You have to read through this. There are a lot of guardrails in place for this system. You know, think about formatting. If you've done any type of JSON file editing, you have to make sure everything's perfect. This will not let you do something in formatting that breaks your entire tailnet. TailScale uses something called deny by default. Essentially, if it's not explicitly allowed, it's going to be blocked. Now, the basic rule inside of here is actually source any, destination any, accept. So for most users on home environments, you don't need to touch this. If everybody has the same level of access, this is super simple. The other thing to understand is this is directional. So if you do allow from one source to a destination, it doesn't necessarily mean the destination is allowed to make a new connection back to the source. If you're familiar with the terms of stateful firewalling, it still does allow the established and related connections back. All of these rules are enforced locally, and that does two things for us. The first thing is efficiency. It means the traffic doesn't have to go the whole way to the control plane to get an accept or deny. And of course, the second thing is whenever you provision this in the access control, it just automatically pushes this out to all of the different clients on your tailnet. I'm going to go ahead and reference TailScale's knowledge base article on this because this is so well done. You should definitely check this out and watch this video if you want to get really in depth here. But basically how this works is we have the ACLs inside of our JSON file format. The first one we see here is actually action accept. And down below you just put source and destination. The cool thing here is you don't have to use IP addresses. You can use devices or users. The great thing about this is you can also have different types of users. So if we go back here really quickly, just into the tailnet and go to users, you can see here we have different roles for users that we can add these individual folks into. We can then reference these inside of the ACLs. It's a really efficient way to make some really good firewalling. But that's all you need to get your tailnet up and running. If anything here was too complicated, make sure you reach out to us at Rogue Support, as our rogues would love to help you with this. As always, thanks for watching and subscribing to Crosstalk Solutions.